For the next couple of chapters, we'll be looking at the physics of astronomy. Our first major topic here is motion and its relationship to forces and energy.
In the middle of the 1600s, the people who studied nature, they called themselves natural philosophers at that time, they had a problem. The invention of the telescope had given good evidence that Earth was a spinning planet orbiting around the sun. But you couldn't feel the Earth moving, so something must be wrong. It was obvious that a new understanding of motion was needed.
This new understanding started with a new question. Usually when people ask about motion, they ask about what makes things move. However, around this time, natural philosophers started realizing that the really interesting question might be, what makes things stop? So in this chapter, we'll start out by looking at ways of describing motion based on forces. This comes from Newton's laws of motion.
Then we'll move on to a different understanding of motion, provided by looking at energy. Depending on what you're doing, either forces or energy can be a very effective way of understanding motion.
After this, we'll focus more specifically on the force of gravity and how it allows us to understand orbits. If we're going to talk about motion, we first have to define our terms. Here we learn a little bit about the culture of science. In some branches of science, biology for instance, it's normal that when someone wants to give a name to something, they pull out their Latin or their Greek dictionary, or if they're feeling creative, maybe both, and use that to invent a whole new word. This makes the vocabulary section of biology textbooks huge, but it's typically not how things are done in the physical sciences. Instead, folks in physics and astronomy often use very common words to describe terms, but they give them very specific definitions that may not exactly match how those words are used day to day. So you need to make sure you know the physicist's definition of these terms, not just the way you might use them in everyday life.
The first term we need to define is speed. We've already talked about this one. Speed is the distance something travels divided by the time it travels. The units will be distance over time, such as meters per second. There's nothing very unusual here.
Velocity is both speed and direction. In other words, with the velocity, you need to know not just how fast something is going, but also in what direction. If you say you're going 65 miles per hour, you're talking about your speed. If you say you're going 65 miles per hour eastbound, you're talking about your velocity.
This distinction really starts to matter with the next term, acceleration. Acceleration is the change in velocity. Since the units of velocity are distance over time, the units of acceleration are distance over time divided by time, or distance divided by time squared. An example would be meters per second or meters per second squared. Any change in velocity is an acceleration. If you speed up, you're accelerating. If you slow down, you're accelerating. And even if you just turn a corner without changing your speed at all, you're still accelerating.
The formula that describes this is delta V equals A times T. The triangle at the start is the Greek letter delta. And in math, this symbol generally means change. So delta V means how much the velocity changes. A is the acceleration, and T is the time. A good example of accelerating is a falling body. When something falls, it has an acceleration of almost 10 meters per second squared. So if you drop something, and it takes 3 seconds to reach the ground, it will be moving at 3 times 10, or 30 meters per second, by the time it hits. So now we can start looking at Newton's laws of motion. Newton's laws are really a way of describing motion. As I mentioned earlier, Newton's laws describe motion in terms of forces. They let you relate how a force of a given size produces a certain change in a body's motion.
Newton didn't invent all of these laws himself. Some of the thinking behind his first law goes back at least to Galileo, several decades earlier. However, he did put them all together into a complete picture of forces and motion that many people regard as the starting point for physics as we know it.
Also, once you get started thinking this way, it's really easy to see Newton's laws at work. They really do explain our everyday experience. In effect, a baby just learning to move around is really learning Newton's laws of motion. But as I said earlier, Newton's laws start with a surprising question. Why do things stop moving? Let's look at Newton's first law of motion. This is sometimes called the law of inertia. It says that a body remains at rest or moves in a straight line at a constant speed unless acted on by a net outside force. Okay, let's pull this apart and see if we can figure out what it means. First, notice that this is the no net force situation. We'll look at this more closely in a minute, but keep in mind that it says that all of the forces are balanced. Also, the first law says that the motion isn't changing. If something is at rest, it stays that way. If it's moving along at a constant velocity, it stays that way. In other words, there is a resistance to change. We call this resistance inertia. Then you come to the unless. So the motion doesn't change unless there is a net force. So let's look at this idea of a net force.
Watch out. Here comes Bruce. He's here to remind us that this is the part of Newton's laws that people most often get wrong. We're often tempted to say that if something keeps on moving, you have to keep a force on it. But this says no, that's not true. We'll see why we have that misconception in a few minutes.
Let's look at forces. A force is any push or pull on an object. Force is directional. The direction you push makes a difference on how something moves. It also means that if you're pushing on something up or down, that doesn't change its motion from side to side. What about net force? That's just the difference between all the forces pushing in one direction versus all the forces in the opposite direction. For example, forwards versus backwards. So if we say there is no net force, then we mean that all of those forces add up to zero. There's the same amount of force forwards as backwards. Okay, what Newton is saying here is that if the forces on a body are equal, then it keeps moving in a straight line at a constant speed. Another way of saying this is that if you are going at a constant speed and direction, it feels like you're standing still. Imagine sitting in an airplane, traveling at hundreds of miles per hour. If it weren't for the vibration of the engines, you might not notice that you are moving at all.
But what about our day-to-day experience, that you do have to keep pushing on things to keep them moving? The reason for that is simple. The moving bodies we experience on the Earth have to deal with another force, the force of friction. Or else with related forces like air resistance. Every time an object is moving, these frictional forces are pushing on it to slow it down. When you push on something to keep it going, all you're really doing is balancing out the force of friction.
There's effectively no friction for something moving through space. As a result, once you push on something, it tends to keep going indefinitely. That spacecraft that just went past is one of the Voyager spacecraft. They were launched back in 1977, and since then, their rockets have hardly fired, yet they've traveled farther than any other object humans have ever made, several times the distance to the farthest planets in our solar system, and they're still going. Now let's look at the second law of motion. This is the net force case. It says that force equals mass times acceleration. So, what does this mean?
First off, it says that forces cause accelerations. If you push on something, it accelerates. It speeds up, or slows down, or it changes direction. you can also turn that around. If you see something accelerating, you know that there's a net force acting on it.
Look at the pitcher throwing a ball. He's exerting a large force on that ball so that it accelerates from stationary to a high speed. As soon as he lets go of the ball, he's no longer exerting a force on it. There's still gravity pulling it toward the ground and air resistance slowing it down, but the pitcher can no longer make it go any faster.
It also says that the more force exerted, the more an object accelerates. If the pitcher puts a large force on the ball, it accelerates more, and hence it gets up to a higher speed than if he exerts very little force. Lastly, the second law says that the more mass an object has, the less it is accelerated. If that pitcher tried to exert the same force on a bowling ball, the ball wouldn't accelerate nearly as much.
Notice that it's the ball's mass that matters, not the pitcher's. We'll worry about the mass of the pitcher when we get to the third law, but for now, we're only interested in the ball and the force the pitcher exerts on that ball. The units of force are just a combination of the units of mass and acceleration. Since we use kilograms for mass and meters per second squared for acceleration, force is just kilograms meters per second squared. We usually shorten this to just newtons. Notice what this means. If you're calculating force, you have to make sure you convert the other units to kilograms, meters, and seconds, or you won't get newtons out as an answer. Similarly, if I give you a force, it will be in newtons. Lastly, we'll often write the second law as A equals F over M. In other words, if you know how much force you exert on how big a mass, you can figure out how much something will accelerate. If you've had some algebra, you should check to see that you know how to get from F equals MA to A equals F over M.
There are a couple more things to remember about the second law of motion. First, it applies to changes of direction, not just changes of speed. I won't have you calculate changes of direction, but you need to appreciate the idea because it's important for understanding orbits. If something is moving in a curved path, like a circle, then there is a force acting on it, even if it's always going at the same speed. In the case of the ball and the string, in this picture, the force comes from the string pulling the ball towards the center. If the string breaks, the force is removed, and the ball goes off in a straight line in whatever direction it was moving at that time. Now it's time to move on to the third law of motion. This is sometimes called the action-reaction law. It says that whenever one body exerts a force on a second body, the second body exerts an equal and opposite force on the first.
For a more direct way of understanding the third law, just try hitting a wall, but not so hard that it does any damage to you or the wall. What you'll find is that while you exert a force on the wall, this doesn't have much effect. However, the wall exerts an equal and opposite force on your hand, and that part hurts. This shows the key idea in the third law of motion. This law deals with the forces between two bodies. It essentially says that when one body pushes on another, the second pushes just as hard on the first. Notice that this is different from the previous two laws of motion. Those just looked at the forces acting on one body. This law is the only one that relates forces between two different bodies.
Another example is the pitcher throwing a ball earlier in this slideshow. The pitcher was exerting a force on the ball, and as he was doing that, the ball was exerting an equal force on the pitcher. So why did the ball go flying and the pitcher didn't? Take a moment and see if you can figure out the answer for yourself. Have you got it? Think back to the second law. Acceleration is force divided by mass. The ball and the pitcher both feel the same force, but their masses are very different. So the acceleration is very different. The ball has a small mass, so its acceleration is large. While the pitcher has a large mass, so his acceleration is small.
A rocket is a nice example of Newton's third law of motion. A rocket works by heating up gas and forcing it out a nozzle at high speed. Since the rocket is pushing on the gas is also pushing on the rocket, according to Newton's third law of motion. It's this push from the rocket's gas that accelerates it forward. It's not pushing off the ground, it's pushing off its own exhaust.
In principle, you could do the same thing. Just stand on a skateboard and hold a bucket of rocks. If you start throwing rocks in one direction, you should start moving in the opposite direction, and that would make you a rocket. If you try this, don't do it any place where people are likely to be hit by the rocks. If rocks aren't an option for you, imagine standing on a skateboard, spraying hairspray in the other direction. Would that work? Now that we've gone through Newton's laws of motion, you should be able to fill in this table. This will help you know which laws apply to which situations. Try filling this in before you do the next your turn. We've already given a few astronomy examples, but you should leave room in that last column to add more examples as we learn about them later in the course.
Now it's time to see if you can apply Newton's laws. We're going to look at the case of riding an elevator. The elevator starts out speeding up to 2 meters per second. Then it goes at a constant speed afterwards. Notice that part B deals with the time when it is speeding up, while part C deals with the time when it's going at a constant speed. Remember to apply Newton's laws to answer these questions. This question gives you practice thinking about the world in terms of forces and accelerations. You should try this more generally. Try looking at things around you and figuring out what forces are acting on them. And do those forces balance out, or do they cause accelerations?